In this lecture, we'll analyze the EXP3 algorithm. As usual, this is funded in part by NSF-CCF 1749864. So recall, this is the statement we wanted to prove. So we wanted to prove that sum t equal to 1 to t ft of A star, where A star is the best action in hindsight, minus the total expected reward in the t time steps by the algorithm, is upper bounded by square root kt log kt. So this is the statement we want to prove. So we'll see how we'll go about proving this. So the strategy is going to be as follows. So recall that the algorithm used fake rewards ft tilde, which is a vector, and it was ft tilde was given as rewards to hedge, and hedge guarantees certain things from the previous lectures on ft tilde. And then note that the way ft tilde and ft is related is the fact that ft tilde is an unbiased estimate of ft for every arm. So the vector ft tilde is an unbiased estimate of the vector ft. And then using expectation throughout, we'll combine these two facts to show that we'll get whatever we want to prove, which is the statement here. In particular, the regret bound is of the order square root kt log kt. Okay, so before we start, let's make one observation. So firstly, recall that each entry in vector ft was in the range 0 to 1. On the other hand, ft tilde need not be between 0 and 1. So let's see what is the range of ft tilde, right? So from the definition of the IPS estimate, ft tilde of A at every time step is ft of A by qt of A if the action you chose at time at is A. Otherwise, it's 0, right? So it's a vector where there's exactly one coordinate which is non-zero, and then the non-zero value is ft of A by qt of A. And recall, this is the definition of qt of A. So qt of A is gamma over k plus 1 minus gamma times pt of A, where this gamma is a parameter that will be fixed later. And recall, pt of A is the distribution returned by hedge. So this is the distribution given by hedge. Okay, so what do we see here? So we see that both the first sum end here and the second sum end here are non-zero. So this implies that qt of A is at least 1 minus gamma times pt of A, right? Since gamma over k is greater than 0, qt of A is at least the second term, which is 1 minus gamma times pt of A. So this implies that ft tilde of A, which is at most ft of A by qt of A, will be at most ft of A by 1 minus gamma times pt of A. So therefore, ft of A can be pretty large. In particular, it can be as large as this. And as long as gamma is strictly greater than 0 or pt of A is strictly greater than 0, this is a bounded quantity, right? So we'll use this fact that ft tilde of A is going to be this large soon. So before we get into the analysis of EXP3, I want to take a slight detour and talk about hedge algorithm again. So recall when we were discussing the hedge algorithm, I said that there's two ways to talk about the multiplicative weight update. For reasons that which was just purely because of historical reasons, I stated it in one particular way. But now here we'll actually state it in another way, and it turns out that this gives a slightly different bound, but this bound will be useful for the EXP3 analysis. So let's recall the algorithm. So the algorithm takes as input this learning rate eta, which is between 0 and half. And you initialize this weight vector w, which is all ones vector for every action. And then in each time step, first you define zt to be sum of all weights across all arms. And then pt of A, the distribution pt is defined where pt of A is just wt of A divided by zt, right? This is for every action. And then you sample at from pt. So these three steps here, this 1, 2, 3 were the same as in hedge. And then step 4 is what is different. Before it was 1 plus eta to the power ft of A. Here instead we'll use the fact that e to the power e to the power eta is approximately 1 plus eta. So you can have this update as follows. So WT plus 1 of A is WT of A times e to the power eta times FT of A. So this is the difference in this hedge algorithm. So these two are, I mean, approximately same when eta is small, and as we saw, eta is going to be of the order 1 over square root t, which means these two are approximately equal, but we'll get slightly different bounds, and that is going to be useful for the analysis of EXP3 algorithm. And what is the different bound we are going to get? So I'm going to leave that as an exercise, since the proof is exactly the same as what we saw for hedge. So I would urge you to try it later. So the bound is as follows. So for every eta which is at most half, you have the fact that sum t equal to 1 to t ft of a star, where a star is the best action in hindsight, minus sum t equal to 1 to t pt, inner product of pt times ft, where pt is the distribution chosen by hedge at time t, is at most log k by eta plus this second order term. So the second order term here is eta times sum t equal to 1 to t, sum a equal to 1 to k, pt of a times ft of a. So note that the term here on the right hand side is depending on the distribution the algorithm chose. So these are, so this here it's depending on pt of a, which is the one chosen by the algorithm. And recall in the previous bound for hedge, which we saw in a few lectures before, this entire term here was instead just t equal to 1 to t ft of a star. That is, it just depended on the best action in hindsight. But this is giving a slightly different bound. In some sense, this kind of captures the variance of the algorithm. I mean, it's not entirely precise, but it's a second order dependence on the algorithm. And the exercise is to prove this thing. So as I said, the proof is exactly the same thing as before. You run the same steps. And at some point, we use the approximation that 1 plus eta to the power ft of a was at most 1 plus eta times ft of a. Instead, here you will need the approximation exp of eta times ft of a is at most 1 plus eta times ft of a plus eta square times ft square of a. And this is true whenever eta times ft of a is at most 1. So you can kind of get this from a Taylor series approximation. And if you just replace in whichever step we use this approximation, instead just use this approximation, and then rest of the steps follows as it is, and then you will be able to prove this, right? So I will leave this as an exercise, and we'll use this guarantee of hedge to prove the bounds on the EXP3 algorithm. So let's see how we do it. So we'll take this guarantee here and apply it on this vector ft tilde. So substituting ft tilde, you get sum t equal to 1 to t ft tilde of a star minus sum t equal to 1 to t pt times ft tilde is at most log k over eta plus eta times t equal to 1 to t a equal to 1 to k pt of a times ft tilde square a, right? So pt of a is the distribution chosen by the hedge algorithm. And recall that we noticed that ft tilde of a is at most ft of a by 1 minus gamma times pt of a. And since ft of a is between 0 and 1, this is at most 1 by 1 minus gamma times pt of a, right? So this is the upper bound. So if you plug in, so if you look at the right hand side in 3, in particular, if you look at this term here, and if you take 1 ft tilde of a, we'll upper bound one of them by this 1 minus gamma times pt of a. So if you upper bound one of them by 1 minus gamma times pt of a, the pt of a and pt of a can gets cancelled. So what we end up getting in the right hand side is right hand side becomes log k over eta plus eta times sum t equal to 1 to t a equal to 1 to k of 1 by 1 minus gamma times ft tilde of a. So the other ft tilde of a remains, and for one of the ft tilde of a, you used 1 by 1 minus gamma times pt of a, and the pt of a and pt of a cancels, right? Okay, so call this equation 4. So we'll now make a few observations and then come back to this equation. Okay, so recall that pt is the distribution chosen by H, right? So in particular, if you give me actions A1, A2 up to AT minus 1, the expected value of FT tilde of AT is exactly PT times FT tilde of A, PT times FT tilde, right? So this is just how hedge works. So for as a shorthand, I will not keep writing given A1, A2, AT minus 1. I'll simply call this as expected value of T. This implies that this is the conditional expectation. So therefore, PT times FT tilde of T is just the expected, is the conditional expectation at T of FT tilde of AT, right? So this is observation one. And the second observation is that FT tilde is an unbiased estimate. So what does it mean? So by definition, we have that expected value, conditional expectation of FT tilde of A is equal to FT of A for every A in K. So for each arm, the conditional expectation is the same. So if you just take expectation over the history, so left hand side is a random variable, so take expectation over its randomness, you get expected value of FT tilde of A is just expected value of the conditional expectation. And the expected value of the conditional, so since the conditional expectation random variable is FT of A, it's just expected value of FT of A. And note that FT of A is no longer a random variable, therefore this is FT of A for every A in K, right? So what we have is the full expectation, expectation over all randomness of FT tilde of A is equal to FT of A for every A in K, right? It's not just that the conditional expectation is equal, the full expectation is also the same. Okay, so we'll use these two observations and go back to 4, right? So 4 is log K by eta plus eta times sum T equal to 1 to T, sum A equal to 1 to K, 1 by 1 minus gamma, times FT tilde of A. So we'll, how do we use this observation? So we take expectation throughout. So take expectation over all the randomness, right? We're taking expectation over all randomness. So it becomes sum T equal to 1 to T. And so of course, we are also using linearity of expectation, which I will not mention henceforth. So what we get is sum T equal to 1 to T, expected value of FT tilde of A star, minus sum T equal to 1 to T, expected value of the conditional expectation of FT tilde times AT, right? Here we are using, so we are replacing PT times FT tilde with the first observation one. So this is essentially this, which is the conditional expectation of FT tilde of AT. And in the right hand side, log K over eta, there's nothing random. And then here you have eta times sum T equal to 1 to T, sum A equal to 1 to K of expected value of FT tilde of A divided by 1 minus gamma, right? So we just took expectation throughout. And observe that expected value of FT tilde of A is equal to FT of A for every A. So therefore, in particular, for A star, expected value of FT tilde of A star is just FT of A star. And this is just the full, so this term expression here is just the full expectation of FT of AT. Again, I'm using linearity of expectation to get the expectation out. So note that AT is random, and therefore this entire expression here still is a random variable. And on the right hand side, we have log K over eta plus eta by 1 minus gamma times sum T equal to 1 to T, sum A equal to 1 to K. And this expected value of FT tilde of A from observation 2 is just FT of A, right? This is true for every A. And what do we know? So we know that FT of A is at most 1, right? So then this expression here, this entire double summation here, is just at most K times T, right? So you're summing over K times T terms, and each of them is at most 1. So therefore, this RHS is at most log K by eta plus eta times K times T divided by 1 minus gamma, right? And here we have still not fixed eta and gamma. So we'll as before, we'll just minimize for eta, and you just differentiate, set it to 0, and we get that the right hand side is at most square root kt by 1 minus gamma times log k, right? So this is after minimizing for eta, and the minimizer eta would be So So you would have, what do we get? So we get, so you get minus log k, or you get log k by eta square is going to be kt by 1 minus gamma. So eta will be square root log k by kt times 1 minus gamma. Right, so this is going to be the minimizer eta, and the minimizing value is square root kt by 1 minus gamma times log k. Right, so here suppose we didn't do the uniform exploration in EXP3, this is purely what you get from the hedge guarantee. But recall that in EXP3 with probability gamma, we used to play an action uniformly at random. Right, at every time step with probability gamma, you used to just pick one of the actions. And so let's condition on at every time step, suppose you played an uniform action. The maximum contribution to regret in that time step could be 1, right? So the best arm could have been giving you a reward 1, and in uniform exploration could have given you a reward 0. So therefore, in expectation in each round, the uniform exploration at most accumulates an additional regret of gamma, right, in each time step. So therefore, your true regret, which is both coming from hedge and coming from the uniform exploration, is going to be at most square root kt by 1 minus gamma times log k plus gamma t, right? So this is the first expression is just coming from here. And the second expression, gamma t, is the total regret in expectation you can get by uniform exploration. Okay, so now let's try to minimize this with respect to gamma. So first note that gamma is at most 1 by design. So therefore, we have the inequality that 1 by 1 minus gamma is at plus 2 plus gamma, right? So this you can get by using the fact that 1 by 1 minus gamma is just 1 plus gamma square, this infinite series, and then rearranging, you can get this inequality. Therefore, square root of 1 by 1 minus gamma is at most square root of 2 plus gamma. So we'll plug this back into 5. So let's, going back into 5, in the first expression here, you can replace square root of 1 by 1 minus gamma with 2 plus gamma. So the RHS is at most square root of 2 times kt times log k plus gamma t plus square root of gamma times kt log k. So here I used a triangle inequality. The fact that square root of a plus b is at most square root a plus square root b. Okay, so this essentially, if you let gamma to be of the order 1 over t, right? So let's say gamma is of the order 1 over t. So the first expression here doesn't have any gamma. So this becomes a constant. Likewise, this becomes something that is asymptotically smaller than kt log k, because the t will get cancelled again. So therefore, the right-hand side is now just upper bounded by order square root kt log k. And this is exactly what we wanted to prove. So the total regret is of the order square root kt log k. And the final value of gamma which we chose was something as small as 1 over t. So the exploration is happening, like, there's almost negligible exploration. Okay, so the proof is fairly straightforward once you get it, once you have the hedge guarantee in the right shape as we want. The rest of the proof is like very standard and easy algebra. So that is the power of EXP3. I mean, the key crux lied in the fact that you need to look at hedge in a particular way. In particular, you wanted hedge to have this form of multiplicative update, which is that it should be of the form, it should be exponential of eta times ft of a and not 1 plus eta times ft of a. So therefore, you can get this second order term that depends on the variance of the algorithm, and therefore just this observation and with some easy algebra gives you the regret bound in expectation. All right, so this proves our main thing, what we want, what we set out to prove, right? Okay, so let's see, how do we now bound the true regret for EXP3? So recall, I claim that you can't bound the true regret of EXP3, except that the bound will be suboptimal. Okay, so if you remember the bound from hedge, the original bound from hedge in the previous lecture, when the payoff range is in a known range between alpha and beta, Then we have the following statement, that with probability at least 1 minus delta, sum t equal to 1 to t ft of A star minus sum t equal to 1 to t ft of AT, which is the realized payoff, is at most beta minus alpha times square root t log k over delta, right? So this is what we had proved, and recall that here the version of hedge we are using is the multiplicative update of the form 1 plus eta to the power ft of A, right? So the one version which we saw originally. Okay, so now the goal is going to be to apply equation 6 on ft tilde, right? So recall ft tilde is defined as follows. So ft tilde of A is ft of A divided by qt of A if the arm you chose at time step t is at and it's 0 otherwise, right? And where qt of A is gamma over k plus 1 minus gamma times pt of A. So here we'll lower bound qt of A by the first term, which is gamma over k. So therefore we get qt of A is at least gamma over k for every action A in k. Therefore, ft tilde of A is at most k over gamma times ft of A, which is at most k over gamma, right? So this is going to be the value beta minus alpha. So this is what is going to be beta minus alpha in equation 6, right? So in the range of the payoffs we are using is beta minus alpha. So now you apply hedge guarantee. So apply the guarantee 6 on ft tilde of A. What do we get? Sum t equal to 1 to t ft tilde of A star minus sum t equal to 1 to t ft tilde of AT is at most beta minus alpha, which is k over gamma, times square root t log k over delta, right? So up to constants, this is the expression we get. And let me call this equation 7. So the problem is on the left hand side, we have these ft tildes, but what we want the bound on is true values ft. Okay, so to do this, we'll take a detour and remind ourselves of some concentration inequality. You've already seen this concentration inequality for hedge, but then there I stated it in a slightly different way, and here I'll again restate it in the way which will be useful to us. Okay, so this is the Azuma-Hefding inequality or Azuma-Hefding bound. What does that say? So let's say we have x1, x2 up till xt, which are random variables, and they lie in the interval 0 to m, right, for some value m. And they're not necessarily independent. So they need not be independent, but they could be independent. Then we have the following statement, that with probability at least 1 minus delta, the absolute value of the sum t equal to 1 to t of xt minus sum t equal to 1 to t of the conditional expectation, that is expectation of xt given x1, x2 up till xt minus 1. Note this itself is a random variable. This expression is a random variable. So we are stating that the absolute value between summation xt and summation of conditional expectation is upper bounded by order of m square root t log 1 over delta, right? So this is what Azuma-Hefding inequality says, that the sum of the random variables concentrates to the sum of its conditional expectation. So, and here these are on any general random variables in the range 0 to m, they need not be independent, right? So this is what is called Azuma-Hefding inequality. So this concentration inequality will be useful to prove what we want to prove. So note, so if x1 and x2 up till xt are actually independent, they're all independent, then what do we have? We have that the conditional expectation, that the expected value of xt given x1 to xt minus 1 is just going to be the expected value of xt. So therefore, what we retrieve is the fact that this equation 8 here just reduces to the fact that the difference between xt and the difference between its mean, which is expected value of xt, is upper bounded by m times square root t log 1 over delta. And this is what is commonly called as the Chernoff-Hefding bounds. So for Chernoff-Hefding bounds, the sum of random variables converges to its expected value. And if they are not independent, then it converges to its conditional expectation. So this is a well-known fact in probability theory, and we'll use this to prove what we want. So here's the guided exercise. So the exercise is to use Azuma-Hefding inequality and the Chernoff-Hefding bounds. And you want to show that ft tilde of A star and ft tilde of AT with equation 7, or which is this, right? Equation 7 is this. This is equation 7. And you want to combine these, and you want to prove that you get the following statement, that with probability at least 1 minus 4 delta, sum t equal to 1 to t of ft of A star, where ft is the real payoff function, minus sum t equal to 1 to t ft of At, is at most order of k over gamma square root t log k over delta. Right? So this, I wanted to prove this. So I would recommend that you pause the video here and first convince yourself that this is true before we proceed further. So the main result will be proved as a series of guided exercises. And I suggest that you pause after each exercise and convince yourself that the statement is true. Okay, so given we have this, now let's see how do we proceed. So recall that this is only one part of it, right? Because with probability gamma in each round, we do uniform exploration. And what does that mean? It means that in expectation, in every time step, you may incur an expected regret of at most gamma t, right? So it's gamma, with probability gamma in each time step, you would do an exploration and you may get a regret of at most 1, and there are t time steps, so in expectation you get gamma t. However, expectation is not enough for us. We want to see exactly what is the realized regret you get due to this uniform exploration. So how do we do that? So here's an exercise. So I want you to show that with probability at least 1 minus delta, the total realized regret due to uniform exploration, right? With so the actual realization of the uniform exploration is upper bounded by this expression, which is gamma t plus square root gamma t log 1 over delta. So gamma t is the expectation and something slightly larger than the expectation, which is square root gamma t log 1 over delta. So once again, I recommend you pause here and you try to do this. So if you need a hint, the hint is as follows. We'll just use Chernoff-Efding bound, which I just described, and on an appropriate set of independent random variables. And then this just directly follows from Chernoff-Efding bounds. Okay, so given this exercise and the previous exercise, let's combine them. So therefore, what do we get? So combine equation 10, which is this, and equation 9, which we just saw here. So this is equation 9. So combine these two. So equation 9 has a k over gamma times square root t log k over delta. And equation 10 has gamma t plus square root gamma t log 1 over delta. So combine them and you want to minimize gamma. So if you notice that in equation 10 is an increasing function of gamma, right? As gamma increases, this value increases. On the other hand, equation 9 is a decreasing function of gamma. So as gamma increases, this value decreases. So therefore, there's a minimizer which will make both those quantities equal. So minimize the value of gamma and show that we have the following bound, that with probability at least 1 minus 5 delta, we have that sum t equal to 1 to t ft of A star minus sum t equal to 1 to t ft of At is at most order of t to the power 3/4 square root k log k over delta. Right? So if you combine 9, 10, take a union bound, so you get the 5 delta, and then we are showing that the upper bound on the realized regret, on the true regret, is at most order of t to the power 3/4 times k log k over delta. Recall that in expectation we got this was something like square root t and that was optimal. So here this is suboptimal, that is we are getting something slightly larger, though it's like still like sublinear, and we want to show this is what we get, right? Again, pause this video and convince yourself that you are able to get this. Okay, so then note that this exercise actually obtains an upper bound on the true regret, but the true regret is suboptimal, right? As we saw, it scales as t to the power 3/4. So you might ask, why is it with the case, right? Because so this comes directly because of the way we define IPS estimates. In particular, the variance of the IPS estimates is really high. What does that mean? It means the following, that the only way we can ever hope to get something like square root t regret is the fact that the maximum allowable value of gamma has to be 1 over square root t, right? Because we have a gamma t that we get because of uniform exploration. And that if gamma is larger than 1 over square root t, that itself will be larger than square root t. So you want to, the maximum allowable value of gamma is at most 1 over square root t. On the other hand, when we saw about the minimizer of gamma, what we chose there was something like t to the power minus 1/4, right? Which is much larger than 1 over square root t. So gamma 1 over t to the power 1/4 is much larger than 1 over square root t, and unfortunately that is a minimizer. And this is the reason why you are not able to get an optimal regret bound on the true regret. So the next lecture, we'll see an algorithm called EXP3.P, which fixes this. So essentially, it makes sure that we can actually get the optimal regret bound on the true regret. And the way we do it is by slightly modifying these IPS estimates. So there's another algorithm called EXP3IX, which I won't go through in this lecture, which is another algorithm that gets the optimal regret bound on the true regret. And that once again modifies these IPS estimates in a slightly different way than what EXP3.P does. And then it also gets the optimal bound. So therefore, both these algorithms kind of get over this fact that IPS estimates have two high variance in slightly different ways. And both are interesting in its own right.